Memorial Day is a day to raise our awareness about the nation's freedom and the price that was paid for our freedom. Every year, United States soldiers and their families pay the ultimate price somewhere in the world. Memorial Day is a day for reverence and honoring of those who gave their lives defending our nation. There has been 2.7 million U.S. military deaths since 1775. George S. Patton wrote this: "It is foolish and wrong to mourn the men who died. Rather, we should thank God that such men live." I understand that we are urged and should take 3 minutes tomorrow afternoon. At 3 o'clock tomorrow afternoon, take a minute to give honor to those that fell in battle or serving our country. So tomorrow afternoon at 3, if you could, take a moment and think about the ultimate sacrifice that these men and women gave. Think of the sacrifices made by U.S. soldiers to provide freedom for us, that we can come this morning and we can gather and worship the Lord and not really have to worry. We can do it in freedom. Amen. This morning, I'm going to ask you to stand with me as we read our text this morning. Philippians 4:11 through 13. The Apostle Paul writes, "Not that I speak from want, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. I know how to get along with humble means, and I also know how to live in prosperity in any and every circumstance. I have learned the secret of being filled and going hungry, both of having abundance and suffering need. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me."
Amen.
Dear God, we stand in awe this morning of your reverence. We stand in awe of who you are. You give us peace that passes all understanding. Lord, we pray and thank you for our freedom. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Freedom is much more than being free. Freedom is something that we learn. I read an article the other day, and as I'm reading this article, it just jumps out at me, mainly the title of the article that I'm reading. I read a comment the other day that really encouraged me, and I hope that it will encourage you this morning. The message is built around this comment: love the life you never wanted. Love the life you never wanted. There is no one in here that planned from early childhood that you planned all your life to where you are today. You've had some hiccups along the way. You've had some areas that you wish you could go back and redo. But guess what? You can't. So we have to love the life you never wanted. There's things in my life today I wish they weren't, but they are. And I can't change them. I have to learn to love the life I never wanted. Amen. We tend to define our lives based on our precept of our progress. Am I making progress? Guess what? what? Some days you are, and some days you're not. Not long ago, I texted someone, they said, how you doing? I said, well, some days I eat the bear, and some days, well, you know the rest of the story. Some days I eat the bear, and some days the bear eats me. So we can't judge life on our progress. Am I where I thought I would be at this age? You might ask yourself that question. Have I achieved what I thought I would? Some of you can say yes, some of you say no, but have you learned to love the life you never wanted because I haven't achieved everything? Are your dreams more or less real today? Am I happy in my marriage, my family, my position at work? Is my life a success? And some of that all depends on who you're talking to, doesn't it? Is my life a success? Or have I learned to live? Have I learned to love the life I never wanted? Listen to me, in reality, life is never defined by our performance or our circumstances. In reality, life is never defined by our performances or our circumstances. We live in a free country, but so many in our country are bound. We may live in a free country, but so many of you are not free. You are bound, tied up in your own mind, and you can't let yourself be free. Oh, Roger, that's tough this morning. Yeah, it's going to get even tougher. Have you learned to be free? What really makes any life worth living today is the presence and protection and pleasure of knowing the Almighty God. That's what will make you free. What really makes any life worth living is knowing that I have God with me and I have His protection with me through this life. Jesus was bound. Jesus was beaten. Jesus was placed on an old rugged cross, and Jesus died there. But let me tell you something. He was always free. Amen. Oh, come on, people. Amen. He was always free. So the idea is not what's happening to me, but what's in here and what's in here sets me free. Jesus was free because he knew of God's presence and God's protection. Jesus was always free because he knew of God's presence and God's protection. Amen. Let's go on. So we say to ourselves, well, that was Jesus. And I'm glad you said that because we're going on to individuals. After being sold into slavery by his brothers, Joseph, rose to power in perhaps the most powerful nation in the world at that time. Genesis 39:2. And the Lord was with Joseph. So he became a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. Now his master saw that the Lord was with him and how the Lord caused all that he did to prosper in his hand. So Joseph found favor in his sight and became his personal servant. And he made him overseer over his house, and all that he owned, he put him in charge. And then Potiphar, his boss, put Joseph in charge of everything. But Potiphar's wife lusted after Joseph, and when Joseph refused her advances, she framed him. Her lies ripped him from his title and put him in jail. Genesis 39:20. So Joseph's master took him and put him in the jail, the place where the king's prisoners were confined, and he was there in the jail. But the Lord was with Joseph and extended kindness to him and gave him favor in the sight of the chief jailer. Hear me. Joseph did well, whether he was in authority or whether he was in jail, because he knew the Lord was with him.
Amen.
We can do well when we're in charge, or we can do well when we're in prison, if we understand the Lord is with me.
Amen.
And his protection is around me.
Amen.
Oh, yes. Thank you, Lord. Absolutely. Whether in power or in prison, Joseph's life was kept filled, hope was filled, because of he knew that God was with him. The Lord was with him in success, and the Lord was with him in prison. So Joseph, through it all, was free. Even when he had chains around him, he was still free. Because he knew the Lord's with me.
Amen.
And if I'm in chains, it's because it's okay with the Lord. And his protection is around me.
Amen.
I don't like what's going on, Lord, but I'll learn to love it because I know you're right here. I don't have to be happy, Lord, but I'll be happy because you're right. You're taking care of me through it all. Now, hear me this morning. There are probably more people happier in prison than they are ruling. More people fall into trouble ruling than they do anywhere else. Power corrupts, and absolute power absolutely corrupts. But Joseph, knowing the Lord was with him and beside him, said, it doesn't matter whether I'm ruling or whether I'm in jail, the Lord's with me. Got a question for you. How good is your life? No. Don't turn to your wife and ask her how good your life is. How good is your life? Somebody just told me yesterday, he said, well, you know what? My life is outstanding. It's wonderful. It's great. And I said, okay, how come you've been through two divorces if your life's so wonderful, so great? Well, I didn't plan on that part. No, you didn't plan on that part. But those parts happen, and we may regret it, but we need to love the life you are now living that you never wanted. Is the life you're currently living the one you always wanted for yourself? I can answer that for you. No, it's not. And most would say no, and you are locked in the prison of what could have been, which changes nothing, but I know God is with me, and so therefore I am free.
Amen.
Four questions. Did you think you would be married by now? Or that you would still be married? Or if you are married, did you marry the person you thought you would marry or when you thought you would marry them? What about your job? Not what you exactly wanted. Not what you hoped for. A very good friend of mine told me the other day, he said, I make too much money to quit, but I hate my job. Do you feel like your gifts are being wasted? Do you dream about doing something different with your life? Maybe you wish you were living somewhere else, closer to home or further away. The reality is that all of us can imagine something better for our lives. Hear me. We can imagine something better for our lives, but hear me, there is nothing wrong with making plans, wanting something else until it binds you in prison.
That's right.
And you're no longer free. I do not believe, I've heard people say, well, God laughs at your plans. I don't think God ever laughs at your plans, but he now and then smiles at your plans. If your plans are sincere, I believe God looks down at me or pats you on the back and goes, you just don't know. You just don't.
Amen.
And I think now and then God lets you have your plans and you look back and go, God, why did you let me have my plans?
Amen.
I'm not exactly being tacky, but I'm being a little tacky. Very, very, very young. There was this girl I thought, God, you've got to give her to me. She just got to be mine. He saw better plans for me, and he gave me Judy. And a few years ago, I saw this one that I thought I had to have, and it was like, oh, thank you, God. God laughs at our plans when they are really heartfelt plans, but I know he smiles at them sometimes. Because if we follow the Lord, he knows what's best for us. God always writes, hear the togetherness. God always writes a better story for you than you would write for yourself.
Amen.
God always writes a better story for you than you would write for yourself. The better is based on this. God himself is the best. Most satisfying thing you could ever have or experience. And therefore, fullness of life comes through him.
Amen.
A couple of hundred years after, or a couple of thousand years, or about a thousand years or so after, Joseph, Paul comes along. And Paul writes some of the same basic things. And he says this in Philippians 4:11. Not that I speak from want, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. I know how to get along with humble means. And I also know how to live with in any and every circumstance. I've learned the secret of being filled and also and going hungry, both of having abundant and suffering need. I can do all things through Christ who gives me.
Amen.
What is the secret of joy and contentment and freedom in the face of whatever life brings? It's centering and anchoring our joy and contentment in Christ. John Piper said, when we have little and have lost much, Christ comes and reveals himself as more valuable than whatever we have lost. And when we have much and are overflowing in abundance, Christ comes and he shows that he is far superior to anything we have, everything we have.
Amen.
Therefore, we can pray with Solomon, and we're coming back to Philippians, but we can pray with Solomon when he prayed, Proverbs 30, verse 8, and he said, keep accepting lies far from me. Give me neither prosperity nor riches. Poverty nor riches, feed me with the food that is my possession, proportion, that I not be filled and deny, yes, and say, who is the Lord? Or that I not be in want and steal, and profane the name of the Lord. Solomon is saying, Either way that drives me away from the Lord, I don't want to go there. I want to be with the Lord, and I want Him next to me through it all. Is the life you're currently living the one you always wanted? Well, no. Are you content? More than content, delighted, ecstatic to have God at your side.
Amen.
And we say amen, and most of us don't even think about it. He's by my side. I can be content. Don't doze off on me this morning because you need this. You need this.
Amen.
Just the other day, and some of why we're hearing this message, I was asked, Brother Roger, how are you doing? Pause for a moment. I thought about this text. And my comment was, I am learning to be content. Listen to me this morning. I don't know how long it took Paul. Paul didn't wake up one morning and go, you know, I'm content with the world. I just love being in jail. I love being beaten. This is all fun. No, it says he did what? He learned to be content. It was a training. I do not know how long it took Paul, but it must have been a process before he could declare, I have learned, I know. He called it, listen, he called it a learned secret. In the midst of all his trials, he learned to keep his focus on heavenly things.
Amen.
He learned the secret, and the secret was, through it all, keep his focus on heavenly things.
That's true. Amen.
I didn't say it was easy. Did I say that? No, it's not easy. But we learn to be focused on heavenly things, and we learn to be focused on the Lord. And we understand that God is near, His love is close, and there is freedom like no other. Are you willing to entrust your soul, your care, to the one who always judges justly? The one who has promised work through all things, including setbacks, including disappointments. God means for all of us, after the convicted Joseph and the burden-beaten Paul, to have their faith, their hope, their joy, and their freedom. Listen. God didn't set Paul out here and say, you're the only one that's ever going to have this joy. He didn't set Joseph out here and say, Joseph, you're the only one that's ever going to have this joy. No. No. We as his children can have what? We can have the faith, the hope, the joy, and the freedom that these men have. Yes. You can. Make him your greatest treasure. And see everything else that happens to you in the light of His pleasure and His security.
Amen.
Learn to love the life you have with God. Learn to love the life you have with God.
Amen.
Even if it is the life you never wanted. A few more verses and we'll wrap this up. Oh, please, listen to John 8:31. So Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed in Him, if you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine. Not just saved, disciples, more so. And you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free.
Amen.
Oh, listen, this is good stuff. Seth Tree has an idea of wandering, free to do whatever. The Lord didn't say, I set you free. He said, I make you free. There's a difference in being set free. If I set you free, that's temporary. I take the chains off you, you wander away, and somebody else could impose. imprison you is set free, is temporary. But when you are made free, the Lord says, I make you.
Amen.
And when you are made free, that is free from whatever is happening to you. To make free means a type, a kind, a style, a mark. It's a freedom that only the Lord can give. To be set free means I am bound. To make free means even if I am bound, I'm free. What did I just say? It's a freedom that only the Lord can give. To be set free means I am not bound. To make free means even if I'm bound, I'm free. To know the truth is to know the Lord.
Amen.
He is the one that said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me.
That's
he said, he is the truth. You want to know what the truth is? It's Jesus Christ. He's the truth.
Amen.
What is truth? Christ Jesus.
Amen.
He's truth. I want to be set free, then know the truth. And that's knowing Jesus Christ. And by knowing Christ, I am set free. Then I got to realize it. I am learning, hear me, I'm confessing. I am learning to be content. I am learning to be free. I know now the secret, now. So now we need to exercise our knowledge. What is our knowledge? I know the truth. The truth can set me free. And that truth I understand, and I live in that truth knowing He is right here. I know the secret now. I know the secret now. The focus of the Lord. I know the secret. So now I have to exercise that secret. I've been set free. There are those that say, well, I'm a Christian. I've been set free. You have been set free. You just don't realize it. Because you're still bound in your mind. You need to be made free. And the Lord is our something we have to exercise our knowledge. That the Lord is our greatest need and strength, our greatest good, and He walks beside me.
Amen.
So therefore, you know what, Charlie? I'm going to love the life I never wanted.
Amen.
Because I'm free.
Amen.
I know the secret.
Amen.
Guess what? This morning, now you know the secret.
Amen.
Paul says, I've learned, he has learned, I'm learning. I'm not near as smart as Paul was. And I certainly haven't been through what he went through. But he learned the secret of being free. He was made free. If you're a Christian, you've been made free. Now we need to exercise that. Would you stand with me this morning? Lord, we thank you for the freedom that you've given us. We thank you for this country, and we're free as a country, but so many are still bound. Lord, you know what's best for us. You know we need to take a right turn or a left. You know all these things. And thank you, Lord, that you've given me. You have made me. And I'm learning to be content in whatever circumstance I'm in. May there be someone here this morning that they do not know or they come to God, setting them free. We live in a country that's free, but we're not free, so they are not, but they can't be. Just by trusting in Jesus as Lord and Savior, and a daily walk with you. In Christ's name, amen.